Welcome to Tokyo Wave, recorded in a live studio in Harajuku, Japan, with your hosts, Aaron and Parker.
All right, everyone, welcome to episode 15 of Tokyo Wave. We're your hosts, Aaron Randall
and Parker Allen. On Tokyo Wave, we bring you weekly updates from our studio in Harajuku.
Join us in segments featuring this week's top news,
political happenings,
business,
and other random garbage.
All right, so to get us started, here are this week's top news highlights.
Japanese government to establish PCR test centers at major international airports.
Japan to phase out 100 coal-fired power generators.
28-year-old man arrested for family restaurant robbery attempt in Shinokubo after 14 hours gorging on pancakes, beer, and fries.
Sounds delicious.
Except for the part about getting arrested.
This week in Japan.
All right, this week's top news story, Japanese government to establish PCR test centers at major international airports.
The Japanese government plans to establish PCR test centers to examine those who enter and leave the country at three major airports, as well as core areas in Tokyo and Osaka, before the gradual lifting of travel bans amid the coronavirus pandemic.
The Mainichi has reported that the government plans to begin preparations from as early as this summer, so that these centers can commence operations at an early stage, in anticipation of Japan gradually reopening its borders.
New PCR test center buildings will be built near Haneda Airport, Narita International Airport, and Kansai International Airport. PCR tests are currently conducted at airport quarantine stations, and it takes around 1 to 2 days for test results to come back. Also, only about 1,000 tests can be carried out in 1 day. By setting up these new test centers, the government aims to reduce the waiting time for test results to a few hours and has set a target of expanding the number of tests that can be done in 1 day up to 4,000 per day.
Oh, wow. So additional test centers will also be built in central Tokyo and Osaka. Government officials have envisioned that these centers will mainly carry out testing on individuals who require certification of testing negative for the virus when departing the country.
Chief Cabinet Secretary Yoshihide Suga commented at a press conference on July 1st that, in order to resume the international flow of people partially and in stages, it's absolutely essential to expand the capability and structure of examinations.
Since February, the national government has strengthened restrictions on entry to Japan in response to the novel coronavirus outbreak. On July 1st, Japan added 18 countries, including Cuba and Cameroon, to a list of regions that face travel restrictions. So, now 129 countries are subject to Japan's entry ban.
Those poor Cubans and Cameroonians.
Nuts.
Before easing travel restrictions, the government plans to negotiate with each individual country while building out its new PCR testing structure.
That doesn't sound like it's going to take a long time.
Each individual country, so it's 129.
Yeah.
I would not want to work for the Ministry of Foreign Affairs right now.
So business travelers from Vietnam are already allowed to travel to and from Japan. I'm very jealous. And the national government aims to do the same for countries such as Thailand, Taiwan, Myanmar, and Brunei.
The government has also entered into negotiations with Australia and New Zealand, but travel between these other Asian countries is expected to come first. Discussions on the matter will also be made with South Korea and other countries in the future. You know, it's kind of ominous that you never hear them mention the United States.
Yeah, we're nowhere to be found on any of this discussion.
Which is, it's both odd and ominous. It's odd because obviously, you know, the U.S.-Japan relationship is often touted as the most important bilateral relationship for Japan, by Japan. At the same time, though, however, obviously the current political and diplomatic situation in America is a little bit less stable than usual, and also America is the coronavirus pandemic epicenter right now. So
absolutely, yeah, the mainland U.S. for sure. You know, a lot of Japanese colleagues and friends have asked about Hawaii though. You know, will they ease restrictions for Hawaii? But I imagine, though, you know, Hawaii, obviously part of the U.S., is going to fall under U.S. I don't think it will have any kind of special travel permissions. But there are a lot of Japanese that, you know, travel to Hawaii this time of year. So, you know, it might make sense to open up just Hawaii for Japan, because there's only, what is it, 928 confirmed cases in the entire state of Hawaii. That's pretty incredible.
Yeah, it's unfortunately, though, I do feel like, you know, when you get a country, you kind of have to get the whole country, right? You can't just be like, only that one.
I think they could make an exception for Florida, though.
You can come from the United States except for Florida.
Yeah. I would not be surprised if when they open up the states again, certain states, they're going to ask when you enter, have you been to Florida? Have you been to Texas? Because, oh my God.
Well, you know, there's that movie that came out, I think, a couple of years ago, where you've got this highly fortified border between Saitama and Tokyo. And there's like they're like warring, and like the country bumpkins from Saitama can't get into Tokyo because there's like a gatekeeper.
Oh, no way. Wow.
Maybe it'll be the same thing in America. And between each state, there'll be like heavily militarized borders with all those crazy people with guns standing there like, y'all got the corona. Y'all can't come in here. No, sirree.
Look at them mask-wearing communists. Let's get them.
For the time being, those who will be permitted travel in and out of Japan amid the gradual lifting of bans are those making business-related trips and business expatriates, technical interns, and other individuals.
The Japanese government expects that there will be around 250 travelers per day. When arriving in Japan, visitors will be required to submit documents, including a negative PCR test certification, as well as a document outlining a plan for the visitors' activities in Japan.
Whoa! So does this mean there's a roadmap now for foreign residents living in Japan who are stuck outside of Japan right now?
No.
Damn. Upon visitors' arrival, PCR tests will be carried out at airports, and those who test negative will be allowed to enter the country. A certificate proving that one has tested negative is also necessary for Japanese nationals when they depart the country. The swift enhancement of the PCR testing structure centering around airports is imperative to expand international travel.
Perhaps we are finally getting a little bit closer to reopening of the borders, but still, nothing is concrete. Obviously, they're doing this expansion of PCR testing capability, but that's it right now. It's just a suggestion of potential easement sometime in the future.
You'd think they'd be a little quicker, though, as they were expecting to have so many visitors for the 2020 Olympics, though.
Maybe that's why they're making those PCR test centers. I mean, building a brand new center is going to take some time. Next up, Japan to phase out 100 coal-fired electric power generators.
Kyoto has reported that government sources said Thursday that Japan plans to phase out 100 or so coal-fired power generators over the next decade, as it looks to cut down on carbon emissions and shift towards renewable energy.
Minister of Economy, Trade, and Industry Hiroshi Kajiyama is expected to announce this move soon. A government panel will be set up to come up with ways to push local utilities away from coal.
As there are limited domestic energy resources, Japan relies on coal for about a third of its energy needs. Of the 114 coal-fired power generators in the country that have been deemed low efficiency, the government aims to decommission 100 by fiscal year 2030.
Instead, the Japanese government will promote renewable energy such as solar and wind power, which provides just 16 to 17% of Japan's electricity generation, as well as look to restart more of the nuclear reactors that were halted following the 2011 Fukushima crisis.
Dun, dun, dun. Well, I guess we're going to have this debate again then, yeah?
Yep, it looks like it's coming back. Haven't heard about nuclear power for a while in Japan, but under this latest strategic energy plan, by fiscal 2030, Japan plans to boost its reliance on renewable energy from the current 16 to 70% to 22 to 24%. And also boost its reliance on nuclear energy from the current just 3% to 20 to 22%.
Shaking my head. Oh my gosh. Under the 10-year plan, Japan will continue to use high-efficiency coal-fired plants.
Japan continues to be the subject of international criticism for dragging its feet on cutting its carbon emissions. Just last December, an environmental group gave Japan two Fossil of the Day awards for refusing to stop using coal, which was announced during a UN climate change conference in Madrid.
In March, despite calls for Japan to set a more ambitious goal, Japan confirmed its target to reduce its carbon emissions by 26% from its 2013 levels by fiscal year 2030 under the Paris Agreement on Climate Change.
Japan is also promoting its clean coal technology in developing countries, arguing that some parts of the world can't afford to quit coal yet and that improving efficiency is a more realistic option.
Another realistic option for Japan is restarting more of those big, fancy nuclear power plants. But that has been a toxic issue, no pun intended, ever since the 2011 Tohoku earthquake and tsunami, which triggered the now infamous Fukushima Daiichi nuclear disaster.
You know, what is Japan going to do about nuclear power? Actually, later in this episode, we will take a deep dive on this issue. Hazmat suits sold separately.
All right, coming up next, 26-year-old man arrested for family restaurant robbery attempt in Shin-Okubo after 14 hours gorging on beer, pancakes, and fries.
The Yomiuri reported that Tokyo Metropolitan Police have arrested a 26-year-old man for robbing a family restaurant in the Shin-Okubo neighborhood of Shinjuku Ward.
On the morning of January 30th, Katsuki Tsushima, of no known occupation, walked into Jonathan's at around 9:30 a.m. So here in Japan, Jonathan's is kind of the Japanese version of Denny's in the U.S. He then proceeded to order a standard breakfast and pancakes, then a beer and some fries and a Doria, and stayed in the restaurant consuming a day's worth of meals over a 14-hour period.
Then, late in the evening of that day, when it came time to pay for the meal, Tsushima brandished a knife at the cash register and said,
"Fork over the money!"
The family restaurant employee responded,
"I'll call the police!"
Tsushima then did the manly man thing and fled the scene without paying his bill of 3,625 yen.
Oh my god. Such a low amount for a full day's worth of food. So Tsushima escaped the scene, but the long arm of the law caught up with him, and he was arrested by police on July 1st.
You know what this means, of course, Aaron. The police have spent months reviewing this security camera footage and setting up traps with pancakes and beer around Shinjuku. And they nabbed him!
The suspect has admitted to the allegations, stating that,
"I haven't had money to eat and drink for a week. I thought I could dine and dash and also score some money, you know?"
You know, if he had a gun and a female partner, this would have been just like Pulp Fiction.
Oh, man. Yeah, yeah. That's wild. I wish he would have had a bigger vision or a bigger dream, though, right? You know?
This story is missing just a couple of more little situational details, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, if this was America, it would have been at a Waffle House.
Oh, yeah. And it would have made, like, the 6 o'clock news, been a 5-second soundbite, boom, on to the next story.
Yeah. But, of course, it would have ended a little bit differently. Instead of, give me the money, I'll call the police, run away, it would have been, give me the money, I'll call the police, gets murdered with an AR-15. then the entire restaurant explodes, and then afterwards everyone catches COVID-19.
And there's a Mexican standoff. But, you know,
that is something about Japan. You can't do a Mexican standoff with knives.
Ah, very true, very true.
Or can you? I never thought about it.
Something for Tarantino to think about for his next film. Yeah, you know, I heard someone was killed at a Waffle House in the States, the owner of the Waffle House, because he asked a patron to put on a mask.
Put on a mask. You're murdered.
Meanwhile, in America.
I wonder if the guy who executed the Waffle House employee paid for his meal.
All right. Then in our next segment for Tokyo Panic Room, we'll be covering nuclear power in Japan.
You're now listening to Tokyo Wave. Tokyo Panic Room.
Prior to the 2011 Tohoku earthquake and tsunami, Japan had generated 30% of its electrical power from nuclear reactors and had planned to increase that share to 40%. Nuclear power energy was a national strategic priority in Japan. However, as of February 2019, of the 54 nuclear reactors that exist in Japan, 42 reactors were operable, but only 9 reactors in 5 power plants were actually operating across Japan's 47 prefectures.
Though all of Japan's nuclear reactors successfully withstood shaking from the Tohoku earthquake, flooding from the ensuing tsunami caused the failure of cooling systems at the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant on March 11, 2011. This was Japan's first ever nuclear emergency. 140,000 residents within a 20-kilometer radius of the plant were evacuated.
After Fukushima, Japan's nuclear power plants closed one by one, and in May 2012, the last of Japan's nuclear power plants went offline for maintenance, leaving Japan completely without nuclear electrical power for the first time since 1970.
Problems in stabilizing the triple reactor meltdowns at Fukushima Daiichi nuclear plant hardened negative public attitudes to nuclear power. In June 2011, more than 80% of Japanese said they were anti-nuclear and distrusted government information on radiation.
By October 2011, while there had been electricity shortages, Japan survived the summer of 2011 without extensive blackouts, which some people had expected. An energy white paper approved by the Japanese cabinet in October 2011 stated that public confidence in safety of nuclear power has been greatly damaged by the Fukushima nuclear disaster and called for a reduction in the nation's reliance on nuclear power.
A comprehensive assessment by international experts on the health risks associated with the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant disaster concluded in 2013. The assessment stated, for the general population inside and outside of Japan, the predicted risks were low and no observable increases in cancer rates above baseline were anticipated.
The Ministry of Economy, Trade and Industry said in 2017 that if the country is to meet its obligations under the Paris Climate Accord, nuclear energy needs to make up between 20 to 22% of the nation's energy portfolio mix.
But nuclear power is still widely unpopular because of the nuclear waste storage issues and perhaps most because of the fear of meltdowns.
However, a recent article in Wired magazine has covered a new idea that might have an answer.
So the basic idea behind all nuclear power plants is the same. Convert the heat created by nuclear fission into electricity. There are several ways to do this, but in each case it involves a delicate balancing act between safety and efficiency. A nuclear reactor works best when the core is really hot, but if it gets too hot, it will cause a meltdown, and the environment will get poisoned, and people will die from radiation poisoning, and everyone catches on fire and runs into the sea, and blah, blah, blah.
The world's last nuclear meltdown was actually the one at Fukushima Daiichi. But a new generation of reactors coming online in the next few years aims to make these kinds of disasters a thing of the past. Not only will these new reactors be smaller and more efficient than the current generation of nuclear power plants, but their designers claim they'll be virtually meltdown-proof. So, what's their big secret? The answer? Millions of sub-millimeter size grains of uranium, individually wrapped in protective shells. It's called triso fuel, and it's like a radioactive gobstopper. Sounds delicious.
So triso, short for tri-structural isotropic, fuel is made from a mixture of low-enriched uranium and oxygen, and it is surrounded by three alternating layers of graphite and a ceramic called silicon carbide. Each particle is smaller than a poppy seed, but its layered shell can protect the uranium inside from melting under even the most extreme conditions that could occur in a reactor. This week we're going to be talking about reactors, but next week we'll teach you how to make a nuclear bomb.
Hearing that explanation, I think my brain just melted a little bit.
While I was reading that, I was like, God damn, sound like a Russian scientist in the movies, you know, talking about how to make the bomb.
I am invincible! Paul Demkowitz, the director of the Advanced Gas Reactor Field Development and Qualification Program at Idaho National Laboratory and Potato Farm, said that,
"In the new reactor designs, it's basically impossible to exceed these temperatures because the reactor kind of shuts down as it reaches these high temperatures. So, if you take these reactor designs and combine them with a fuel that can handle the heat, shit, you essentially have an accident-proof potato."
It's like with the Titanic, you know? I don't think anything's accident-proof.
Joel Dooling, another interesting character, the president of the Nuclear Operations Group at BWXT, a company that makes triso fuel and nuclear reactors, said that with triso fuel,
"Now you don't have to go build this large containment vessel that costs hundreds of millions of dollars for a reactor, because the fuel carries its own containment. So you can have a reactor that fits in a cargo container and still has all the safety features of a traditional commercial reactor."
Triso fuel has been around since the 1960s, but it was expensive to manufacture and didn't have enough energy density to meet the needs of the giant light water reactors found in most of the world's nuclear power plants.
Recently, the U.S. government has bankrolled a lot of the research that has gone into developing this new tech. BWXT is one of just two companies in the U.S. developing triso fuel for commercial production, and it is also supplying it to the U.S. government for use in its experimental 3D printed nuclear reactor. Wow, that sounds awesome.
That sounds like a good idea.
Yeah.
It needs to be 3D.
Is this nuclear reactor safe? Yeah, man, we made it with a 3D printer. I just popped it right out of there. Of course it's safe.
Another company, Maryland-based X Energy, is a relative newcomer to the nuclear energy business, but has been operating a pilot triso production facility at Oak Ridge National Lab since early last year.
Which must be surrounded with a moat full of sharks with frickin' lasers attached to their heads.
An ominous, very tall Russian guys circling their perimeter.
And everyone's bald.
Yeah, they're all bald.
Turning raw uranium into triso is a multi-step process. The pellets made by BWXT come in a conventional shape, a small cylinder the size of a bullet. Great comparison. But X Energy is putting its triso fuel into a shiny silver orb the size of a billiard ball, just like the one that the Saudi president and President Trump touched, I guess. Clay Sell, X Energy's CEO and a former secret agent, Deputy Secretary of Energy for the United States, likes to call them power balls and says that they'll be used to fuel the company's new reactor, the XE-100.
My name is Clay Sell, and I made the first 3D VR AI-powered crystal ball nuclear reactor.
Well, you know, what is it? Isn't Powerball that big gambling thing?
Yes,
yeah,
yes.
The lottery,
yes.
Right?
Yeah, it gets up to like 160 million.
Now, you thought that Powerball was a gamble. We got one full of fucking nuclear fuel.
This shit can blow up the earth.
$5 a ticket for your chance at world domination.
Dude, this all sounds like Terminator shit. The XE-100. Parker, for this next bit, we're going to have to call in our chief nuclear research assistant to cover this.
Bring him in.
All right.
The XE-100 is a small pebble-bed reactor that is designed to produce just 75 megawatts of power. For the sake of comparison, the smallest operating nuclear power reactor in the United States today produces around 600 megawatts.
Thanks so much to Johnny Farts, our chief nuclear research assistant.
Thank you, Aaron.
So, Pete Papano, X Energy's vice president of fuel production, likens his mini reactor to a gumball machine.
The power ball goes down through the core, comes out the bottom, and then goes back up to the top.
There are other benefits, too. Rather than needing to have miles of open space around a reactor, future plants running on triso fuel could be situated close to their users. That's right, a power ball in your backyard. Just this year, the Department of Defense made a deal with both X Energy and BWXT to terminate the Soviet Union and develop a small mobile nuclear reactor for remote military bases. NASA is also considering triso fuel for nuclear weapons, a future nuclear-powered spacecraft.
Powerball in our backyard? Well, I tell you what, they sell if you put one in your backyard, you can get 5 free tickets to the Powerball lottery.
X Energy's reactor is currently under review by the Nuclear Regulatory Council. They are aiming to do a full-scale demonstration of the reactor within the decade. In the meantime, both X Energy and BWXT are focusing on expanding triso production facilities so that when the next generation of nuclear reactors arrive, they'll have the fuel they need to eliminate the risk of meltdowns.
And enemies.
And workers that push the wrong buttons.
They're going to have to reboot The Simpsons for this one. Yeah. Well, it looks like we will finally have safe nuclear power in little over a decade. That's kind of a buzzkill.
You know, it was disheartening to hear earlier that Japan is planning to go from 3 back up to 20-23% of nuclear energy. I do have some engineering friends, and, you know, even if you just do some reading about nuclear energy and power, it actually is a great, efficient, and renewable source of energy. It sucks that it has all of these terrible consequences, though, if just one small thing goes wrong in the process. I guess I'm glad other companies are looking in to how we can develop and expand and get out of nuclear. But, you know, having, you know, 20 to 100 facilities on the ring of fire, it's got to be one of the worst ideas, in my personal opinion, for a Japan situation.
Obviously, in the short term, though, we do have to somehow generate electric power. And obviously, even as technology gets better and we expand the energy mix in Japan, it's pretty hard to think of a situation where we manage to avoid using nuclear power. Obviously, it seems like the long-term strategy is to shift to non-nuclear sources of energy, but especially when you're thinking about the impact on the local environment from fossil fuels such as coal and Japan's commitment to these international accords such as the Paris Agreement, it's really hard to think of any way other than nuclear power that Japan would be able to meet these numbers.
Yeah. You know, I'm curious if they've publicly announced this change back to using 20 to 23% nuclear. Has Abe made any kind of announcement?
You know, I really do think the Japanese government has been very careful in making any statements regarding nuclear power, because every time they do, people go crazy.
Oh, yeah. It's a total taboo topic for any politician right now in Japan.
I mean, if you went out on the street and put a microphone in front of people and said, do you know that Japan's going to go back up to 20% nuclear power in the next 10 years? They'd probably look at you like, oh my God, no, don't do that. Yeah. I mean, it's a nuclear issue.
Yeah.
Literally and metaphorically.
Hey, listeners, that's right. You listener right there.
We want your feedback, comments, and ideas. Drop us a line at wave@tokyowave.jp. We will listen to your ideas, and we might even try something new.
We hope you enjoyed Tokyo Wave.
If you haven't already, you can subscribe to our podcast on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, SoundCloud, and YouTube.
Join us again next week on Tokyo Wave.
Don't die of radiation poisoning.
Or coronavirus.
We're screwed.
Or the new swine flu.
Oh, there's another one?
Yeah.
Boink.